Hello and welcome to a special interview for The Wire. For years, if not decades, we've been saying the IAS is in decline, but that's impressionistic or anecdotal. Now we have an analytical study done by an insider who spent his entire life in the IAS. He's a person who's risen right to the top of the profession. He's been Rural Development Secretary as well as Secretary to the Planning Commission. And his book has recently been released. And here it is. It's called What Ails the IAS and Why It Fails to Deliver an Insider's View. And today, the author is my guest. His name is Naresh Chandra Saxena. Mr. Saxena, in the foreword to your book written by Harsh Mandir, a former IAS colleague and someone you greatly admire, Harsh writes, "There can be no doubt that India's higher civil services as a tribe have let the country down at moments in our history when it was needed the most." To what extent do you agree with Harsh's indictment of the IAS?
Well, I think it's generalization, because certainly there has been some decline in the moral fiber of the IAS, but that decline is not very high, number one. And IAS has many virtues. In fact, my book is full of admiration for their hard work, competence, even remaining aloof from politicians. But they are there are problems which are of course I've listed in the book, because of which India has not done very well on social sector, on maybe sanitation and health. Education, these are some of the areas where our focus has been rather weak and we have not done very well.
I'll come to those in a moment's time. Yeah. But am I correct in understanding that you don't agree with Harsh when he says that they have let the country down in moments in our history when we needed them the most?
It's very hard-hitting, I think, although I have a lot of admiration for Harsh. But to say that they have let down the country won't be true. In fact, they could have done better, certainly.
But they haven't let down?
They have not let down.
Let's come to what afflicts the IAS, or in a sense, to use your phrase, what ails the IAS. The paradox is that the IAS still attracts some of the brightest, some of the most idealistic young men and women. But what seems to happen after they join the service is that the environment and conditions in which they work seem to drive them towards corruption or misuse of authority. I'm going to quote from your book. You say, "Bright men and women join the IAS, but adverse work environment, constant political interference, frequent and often meaningless transfers, and corruption below and above them all lead to the erosion of idealism and encourage at least some of them to misuse their authority." So there's a real sense in which the service is corrupting good people.
Well, as I have said, some of them. It does not apply to everyone. In fact, I have given the percentage also. In my view, about 75% of IAS officers are honest. They may enjoy some perks, but in terms of those who would keep money under their pillows, or I think the number is not so high.
But wouldn't the you say even 30% is quite significant?
Well, of course it is. 25 to 30% would be very significant.
And yeah. That's the percentage in your belief that because of the conditions of service after they join, get corrupted.
It varies from state to state. In some states, northeastern states, Punjab, UP, the percentage may be higher. But there are also states where maybe it may be as low as 10 to 15%.
Why would it be higher in Punjab, for example? UP, many would instinctively understand. Why Punjab?
Punjab has always been, I think IAS has never done very well in Punjab, because Punjab is a case of people being well off, but government is not doing very well. And the officers in Punjab has never taken their job seriously. So there are many reasons because of which Punjab IAS officers have not done as well as I would say Rajasthan or even Madhya Pradesh.
Would a state where in fact the percentage is below 30% include states like, say, Kerala?
Yes, certainly. Certainly, yes.
So these are states, Kerala, where the idealism with which recruits join the service is maintained or even nurtured and encouraged, whereas in Punjab, to take the opposite example, the idealism with which they join gets diminished over the years.
There are many factors because of which corruption remains low in some states. It is because of peer pressure, it is because of the general culture in that state, and because of which they remain comparatively honest.
And this makes an all-India view of the IAS actually quite difficult.
Yes, in fact, you are right that all-India view of the IAS is not, would be a generalization. Picture varies from state to state.
In fact, this is the corollary. How well the IAS is performing, or to what extent it's not performing, depends very much on the state about which you're talking.
To some extent, yes. In the sense that some states like Madhya Pradesh or Chhattisgarh or Rajasthan or Odisha or Gujarat, if they have done well in some programs, it is both because of political culture and because of leadership from the chief ministers, etc., which have prompted IAS officers also to perform. But at the same time, even in these states, you find that many things which are relating to processes, relating to control over the lower level functionaries, that requires to be improved.
Now, the interesting thing in your book is you point out that in the 40s, 50s, and even during the first 5-6 years of the 60s, the things were very different. In those years, the IAS was looked up to for its incorruptibility, for its caliber. You say in your book that the situation started to change, the rot in a sense began to creep in with the elections of 67. What happened then?
Well, in the 50s, even up to the 60s and 70s, the general impression was that the IAS is being controlled by the IAS. So therefore, junior officers felt that it is their seniors who would judge whether they are good or bad, and their transfers and postings and promotions would also be decided by senior officers. There was also a general awe of the IAS among politicians, and they also did not want to meddle with the IAS officers. Gradually, the hold of politicians started increasing, and then the IAS people at the top also started, you know.
And you say that the hold of politicians began increasing when coalition governments rather than single party governments became the norm.
One of the factors was that coalition governments, weak governments, also the fact that, you know, corruption started increasing.
And the reason why coalition governments became more interfering is because there was more opportunity for MLAs to make direct contact and to impose themselves on IAS officers.
That's right, because the MLAs also wanted to have IAS officers under their control, especially at the district level, because they wanted patronage, they wanted to benefit some contractors or
The other like factor that. You mentioned is that post 67, you have the emergence of regional parties who often gave priority to local rather than national interests. And once again, this gave opportunity for political interference with IAS staff.
That's right. That's another factor because of which the ethical deterioration started taking place in the IAS. Also, another factor is, you know, IAS is like an inverted pyramid in the sense that there are too many people at the top and too few at the middle and lower level. Because of that, what happens is that there is intense competition among the top people to get the top job. Like there could be, as I have said in the book, 10 officers of the level of chief secretary. So they would be competing among themselves to become chief secretary, and they would then be quite willing to pay a price, be amenable to politicians to get that job. So that is another factor because of which there has been this downfall in their standards.
Now, side by side with the manner in which the change in Indian politics has begun to undermine the IAS and its integrity, you also talk about another change which affected the internal ethos of the system. The trust and support that junior officers had from their seniors began to wither and slowly disappear. Writing of the old days, you say, the assistant collector would often become a member of the collector's household. The young officer could then look forward to the future with confidence, hope, and optimism. And as you point out, it was the norm for senior officers to willingly defend their juniors if it was an honest and innocent mistake. That relationship has not just diminished, is probably seized. Why did that happen?
That happened because of political interference. That happened because quite likely that the senior officer owed his posting because of some political contact, or because the junior officer also thought that it is in his interest to cultivate MLAs or important politicians in order to get a good job. Unfortunately, in the IAS, especially after the first 15 years, the number of important posts is very low, and there are a large number of superfluous or useless redundant postings. With the result that IAS officers are very keen that they should remain in important postings. And because of this consideration, they are willing to pay a price and hobnob with the politicians.
So a mixture of personal ambition, which I suppose is to an extent understandable, and the almost worm-like influence of politicians, right? The two have combined both at the top of the pyramid and at the bottom of the pyramid to actually undermine the very structure itself.
That's right. That's how it has happened.
In this connection, you have in your book a very telling story about Morarji Desai when he was Chief Minister of Bombay, as it was called at the time. His revenue minister, a gentleman called Rasik Lal Parekh, came to meet him, claiming that he was upset with, didn't want to keep his secretary and wanted him transferred. And he, in a sense, got a flea in the ear from Morarji. Yeah, yeah. What did Morarji say?
He said that, look, what is the what has liking or not liking to do with the administration? He's the chief secretary, he's the revenue secretary, let them continue. You may or may not like them, but they are doing their work. So therefore, at that point of time, there is a lot of autonomy or independence given to IAS officers to function. And they performed because of this trust, which has been gradually getting eroded. Also, corruption has been increasing, plus a large number of other factors. But let me also say that things are not so bad in Government of India. And because of that, because of the fact that when people come to Government of India, they have a stable tenure of 5 years as Joint Secretary, 4 years as Deputy Secretary. And the general feeling is that selection to Government of India is done on merit. If you look at the quality of the people who have been cabinet secretaries, they've all been very good officers.
The problem is at the state level.
At the state level, in some states it's very serious, in some states it is manageable.
And is this because state level chief ministers and ministers and other politicians don't regard the IAS in the same way as the central government does? And also they're more willing to interfere in the role of the IAS?
In fact, central government is very keen that the IAS should continue, because this also helps the central government to keep a control over this state. State governments are sometimes not so keen to have IAS officers because they feel that IAS officers are not so pliable as the state level officers are.
Now, so, all of this over the years changed the relationship between civil servants and their political masters. You quote in your book how in 1949, Sardar Patel, who was Home Minister at the time, said that civil servants must have the independence to speak out freely and fully. That may have continued in the 50s and early 60s, but increasingly from the 70s onwards, and particularly in the 80s, 90s, loyalty to politicians has become a much more important concern than independence because of the rewards loyalty brings. You know that if you commit yourself loyally to the chief minister or a minister, he will reward you and you will benefit. Standing up and pointing out to him where he's wrong would probably get you punishment and you might get sidelined. That's very sad.
In fact, you are right. But at the same time, let's not forget that in the 90s or up to the 90s, the general impression amongst the state level politicians was that good governance is not compatible with good politics. So therefore, they were not keen on promoting good governance. But in the last 15, 20 years, picture has been changing.
So there's been an improvement in the last 15 years?
There has been improvement. Many chief ministers feel that if they want to fight anti-incumbency, they must perform.
Yeah, these are the Nitish Kumars, the Naveen Patnaiks.
PDS in Chhattisgarh, wheat production in Madhya Pradesh, water management in Saurashtra, you know, KBK districts in Odisha, they have done very well.
But, you know, there's a paradox, isn't there, Mr. Saxena? As you point out, the nadir was reached in the 90s And in the last 15 years, there's been an improvement because politicians have begun to realize that good governance does win votes.
Yes.
And yet, as you point out in your book, the civil service itself doesn't respect officers like an Ashok Khemkar and Arun Bhatia, who stand up for principle, who stand up for procedure. They have been punished because of the stance they've taken, but they don't get respect as a reward from their colleagues.
In fact, no, the opinion about Ashok Khemkar and Bhatia, officers of that kind, is divided. Some people admire them a great deal, but there's a second viewpoint, which is that, look, we are here to perform, to do something. If we keep on fighting the system all the time and do nothing, then what is the point? You are not justifying your existence. So therefore, some people feel that you have to also do some good performance so that people benefit. Otherwise, just fighting the system, of course, is bad. But criticizing the system all the time and fighting with the politicians all the time does not always bring laurels. That is another viewpoint which I have expressed.
Absolutely. But I suppose the point I'm making is that if the civil service itself is in two minds about the Khemkars and the Bhatias, then it's hardly surprising that politicians simply will not tolerate a civil servant who stands up and sticks by the rules. And what happened to you when you were Rural Development Secretary, I think, is a very telling example. Vajpayee was the Prime Minister of India. Your Rural Development Minister wanted a government grant given to an RSS-linked organization, and as Secretary pointed out, this was not permitted. He got very angry. He complained to the Prime Minister, and the surprising thing is the Prime Minister then expressed his feelings of being upset, not, by the way, to the Minister who wanted something wrong done, but to you. And as a result, you got removed from Rural Development. And this happened under a man like Vajpayee, who people believe was perhaps a stickler for propriety, and clearly he wasn't. He buckled to his minister rather than stand up and defend his civil servant.
I would say that, first of all, I was not transferred immediately. It happened, took 3-4 months' time. Secondly, although Mr. Vajpayee was a bit annoyed with me, certainly, but he did not send me back to the state, which would have been a real punishment.
He sent you to the Planning Commission.
He sent me to the Planning Commission, which he thought the Planning Commission has got no authority or has no patronage to give. And Planning Commission is not regarded as a very good post. But I really enjoyed myself, so I have no regrets.
From your personal point of view, as you point out in a book, you benefited.
Yes, certainly.
But the interesting thing is that from Mr. Vajpayee's point of view, he believed that he was punishing you. And the more important thing is that when his minister wanted something done that was wrong, a government grant given to an RSS-linked body which the rules don't permit, in a sense, he sided with the minister doing the wrong rather than with the civil servant who was saying, no, sir, you can't do it. And the civil servant was in the right, but he didn't side with you.
Well, that is part of the game. I mean, that I don't expect politicians to take a decision on totally independent or impartial way. Politicians will always like to benefit people of their own constituency, people of their own caste, people of their own, those who are benefiting from them. It could be contractors, it could be mafia gang, who knows. But that one has to accept.
And the sad part is that this is true, it seems, of all politicians, regardless of which party they come from. In your book, you talk about how a colleague of yours, someone you hugely admire, in fact, in your book, you say, as a civil servant, he should have got the Nobel Prize of the Bharat Ratna, Harsh Mandir.
Yeah, yeah.
After serving 2 years in this National Advisory Council, Dr. Manmohan Singh denied him a third year.
That's right.
And clearly you were upset. Explain to me, why do you think Dr. Manmohan Singh, who many people uphold as a sort of paragon, denied someone like Harsh Mandir a third term?
Well, the story which I heard was that Dr. Manmohan Singh was not very keen on welfare programs. In fact, in a meeting which I had with him, he was not happy even with NREGA. And NAC at that point of time was suggesting many programs. The most important was the Food Security Act and the Communal Violence Act, which he was very upset with. He thought that Communal Food Security Act would mean that subsidies will increase and wastages would increase because it will not reach the poor people. and Communal Violence Act. There were problems also with the Communal Violence Act, I would say. So therefore, he felt that the NAC, because of the pressure from Harshmandar and one or two others, was taking a line which was not to his liking. So he did not renew their contract.
So Harsh, in a sense, was troublesome, if I can use that word, because he was pushing for measures that Dr. Manmohan Singh didn't agree with.
Did not like, yeah.
That's and the
like.
Only way for that pressure to cease was for people like Harshmandar to be taken out of the NAC.
That's right. That is what happened. He was taken out of the
NAC. Interesting thing is, when you write about this incident in your book, you add, and I'm quoting you, Mrs. Gandhi would have liked him, Harshmandar, to continue, but could not overrule the Prime Minister. Do you really believe that? For most of us, Dr. Manmohan Singh was her creature. And forgive my colloquialism, most of us believe that if she'd snapped her fingers, he'd have been doing somersaults.
I thought the arrangement between the two was that that Dr. Manmohan Singh would look after administration and Mrs. Gandhi would look after welfare programs. So therefore, administrative systems, transfers and postings was left to Dr. Manmohan Singh. Now, in this case also, I don't know what exactly happened. I did protest to Mrs. Gandhi, and she sent me a reply or two on this issue.
Which you publish in your book as the annexure to
chapter 10. That's right. But I feel that Mrs. Gandhi, beyond a point, did not want to have confrontation with the Prime Minister.
Although the interesting thing is that in his book, Sanjay Baru points out how Pulok Chatterjee would be taking PMO files to Mrs. Gandhi, which clearly is a breach of the rules. And I know for a fact that the person that Dr. Manmohan Singh first chose to be the Commonwealth Secretary General was replaced at Mrs. Gandhi's insistence by Kamlesh Sharma because he was a family friend of the Gandhis. So there are moments when, you know, Mrs. Gandhi's had a way, even if it's a breach of the rules, right, and even if it's going to embarrass the Prime Minister because he can't stand by a man he's originally chosen for the job.
That's right. There were these problems.
Harsh, I suppose, was unlucky. He didn't have the same level of commitment from Mrs. Gandhi. Had he, she would have stood by him.
No, I think Harsh, Mrs. Gandhi was very fond of Harsh. And even now, I think they are meeting, and we had a separate meeting with both of them. But she did not pursue it beyond a point.
Now, in your book, you suggest a number of imaginative reforms for checking the decline in the IAS. You want greater stability of tenure. You want encouragement of professionalism as well as domain knowledge. You want more value attached to departments that you believe are important for the poor, such as health, education, labor, child welfare. To what extent will governments in India, and I don't just mean the Modi government, I mean all governments, to what extent will they accept this almost reprioritization of the way they approach ministries?
In fact, Government of India, sometime in 2006, had accepted the issue that there should be stability of tenure. And they did many things.
For all secretary-level posts?
Not for all secretary-level posts. They said, okay, for certain secretaries like Cabinet Secretary, Finance Secretary, Home Secretary.
The finance would be the only one that's excluded. Defense and Home and Cabinet Secretary.
They would have a stable tenure. Not only that, they made some changes in the holiday services rules. And they said that the state government should also have a stable tenure.
That hasn't followed through.
That has, you know, the rules have been changed. But it says that in case you want to deviate from these rules, you have to take the permission of the cabinet, chief secretary, etc. What happens is in the state governments, chief ministers deviate from this rule, and the chief secretary just signs it. So therefore,
again because of the way chief secretaries believe it will pay them to do what the chief minister wants, because they'll get rewarded later on.
That's right. So it is both ways. The chief secretaries want to continue in that job, and chief ministers would also select someone who's pliable.
So many of the things that you believe could check the decline are actually rules that exist. They just need to be enforced, and enforced honestly.
Not only rules have to be enforced, there has to be monitoring. Today, if Niti Aayog starts monitoring, what is the tenure of chief secretary or other important secretaries in the state and starts putting it on their website, I'm sure there would be some pressure on the states.
But you know, you call for such things as give more importance to ministries that matter to the poor, health, education, labor, child welfare. Now, that's not just a question of the government changing its priority, which it badly needs to do, because as governments historically, education and health have been subjects that are ignored by the budget. But it also means that civil servants have to change their priority to these ministries.
Civil servants certainly have greater priority for finance or for, IT or things
or
like
home.
That, or home. But at the same time, it is always possible to get very good officers for health and education. There are people who want to specialize in these subjects.
Because their inclination is in that direction.
Inclination is in that direction. They feel that they can specialize and they can get some job with the United Nations. They feel that they can work as consultants after their retirement. Also, they feel committed to that sector and they feel that there is advantage to them if they specialize and they have.
So if the government gives priority to these ministries, the civil servants to man them will be readily available.
In fact, government has given priority in the sense that a lot of money is allocated to these ministries.
But no one cares how it's spent.
But now, that is the main problem, that how it is spent and how benefits are not reaching the common people, that is not being monitored, that's not being evaluated. And in fact, reports which come from the state governments are often totally...
This is where monitoring is important. And this is where giving importance to monitoring and to outcomes rather than just inputs would make a big difference.
That's right. Not only we need to monitor outcomes, but we also need to study the processes because of which outcomes are not
And all of that will happen if you give greater importance to the ministry, because this will be immediately the follow-up.
That's right. And whenever importance is given, like to sanitation in the current regime, one finds that very good work has been done.
This is where the Swachh Bharat is such
yes.
an important thing the Prime Minister has done. And the fact
that
he's put himself behind it
right.
means that he's giving it importance, and therefore it goes up in the eyes of the civil service as well.
That's right. So sanitation has got the political importance, so it is being implemented.
Now, you also propose other measures that would impact on the efficiency of the service. Here you talk about 25 to 50% of civil servants should be retired at the age of 55, as you say happens in the armed services. You say officers should be encouraged to join NGOs and research institutes mid-career and should be allowed to be out of the system for as long as 7 years at a time. You also call for lateral entry and third-party independent evaluations. One of these, at least, lateral entry, is being attempted by this government. But I gather the civil service itself doesn't like lateral entrance. It's resistant to them.
In fact, views on this are divided. Many civil servants are not in favor of lateral entry, but I have supported this. Also, let's not forget that in the 90s, recruitment to the IAS had been reduced drastically, because Mr. Chidambaram thought at that point of time that after liberalization, we would not need IAS officers, so many IAS officers. The reverse happened. After liberalization, our revenues increased, so allocation for education, health, and these welfare programs, NREGA, etc., increased. So therefore, these ministries expanded. But because the recruitment had been very limited, today, if you are looking at officers with 20 years of service, they are just not there.
Which is why lateral entrance is
needed.
That
is why lateral entry is needed. And so long as it is being done by the UPSC, and people with reputation and people with credibility are selected. I think our experience in the past has also been very good, whether it is Vijay Kelkar or Dr. Manmohan Singh or Dr. Ahluwalia, they have all done very well.
So provided lateral entrants are brought in a fair, credible and open manner, handled by a system like the UPSC, civil service has no problem.
That's right.
What about the suggestion that you make for independent third-party evaluations? Would either the civil service or politicians accept that?
Actually, it is being done. In fact, much of the evaluation of programs is being done not by government organizations. It is being done either by World Bank-funded organizations or by civil society, like Pratham. Pratham evaluates education, and Pratham's reports are accepted. The quality of teaching.
So you're saying formalize what's happening
in
one or two areas.
It is being done only by Government of India. State governments don't evaluate their programs, or they, if they evaluate, they take it as a patronage activity. They'll give it to some NGO whom they are friendly with and who would be told that don't give a very critical report. So therefore, third party evaluations are being done by some ministries, education, health, they are doing it. It is not being done in Government of India for those programs which are not doing well, like ICDS.
Because it would expose that fact.
It will expose that. And or NREGA.
And yeah. You're saying they need to be done in those, and they need to be done in state governments as well.
That is very important.
Because this again would ensure that the focus is on outcome.
Yes.
Money is not wasted.
Yes.
And therefore people realize that they need to be more efficient in the job they do. Otherwise, they'll fail the evaluation.
That's very, very correct, yeah.
Now, before I end, Mr. Saxena, I want to come to two points you make in your book about the prejudice and the bias that Muslims in India face. After accepting the Satchar Committee findings that on a whole range of socio-economic criteria, Muslims actually are disadvantaged, you add, and I'm quoting, because Muslims find themselves in a non-Muslim and hostile environment, they like to imagine that they would be rejected in the employment market on grounds of religion, and therefore do not concentrate on developing their talents. Thus, Muslims become victims of a self-fulfilling prophecy. They predict rejection first, and their withdrawal from competition proves their prediction. It seems to me, in a very real sense, you're suggesting that their attitude and their self-perception is also becoming their first worst enemy.
In fact, it's a very complex problem. Much has to be done by government, because government and administration have not been able to provide a discrimination-free environment, an environment in which they feel secure. In fact, even during the Congress regime, you find that whenever riots took place, a very large number of Muslims were killed, and police also acted in a very biased manner, etc., etc. At the same time, I would say that Muslim leaders have also not been giving them good direction. That look, what is it that you can do? Why can't a Hindu parent, he wants to send his child to a convent, why not to madrasa? Why don't you open the madrasas to Hindu children so that they interact and bias is reduced? The main problem Muslims face today is a very strong bias which has been used by the current government, which has become almost like poison. So that needs to be addressed, for which a lot of work has to be done by government and administration, but some initiative also needs to be taken by Muslims.
In fact, when you say, and again I'm quoting you, they like to imagine that they would be rejected in the employment market on grounds of religion, and therefore do not concentrate on developing their talents. Right. Their belief that their religion would be held against them leads to them not making the full effort they could as individuals to get the best for themselves.
Right.
They see themselves as victims, they see themselves as people who the system works against, and they do very little to help themselves as a result. They accept their lot.
That's right.
That's what I mean by acceptance and self-perception.
In fact, there is a study which I have quoted that in Rampur, which has 72% Muslim population, percentage of those who got first division in intermediate was only 2%. Now, this is because of three factors. One is that they are poor. Second is that there is this feeling of discrimination and they don't study themselves. And the third is that they are in those professions where education is not seen as important. They are weavers, they are tailors, they are bangle makers. They feel that what is the point? All these three factors, they combine to keep Muslims they are in education, they are not doing as well.
Which is why you say they need to change their attitude and they need to change their perception of themselves so that they are more able to help themselves grasp the opportunities that come their way. At the moment, their attitude and their self-perception is something that's holding them back.
It's self-refuting.
Now, you make another point, and some would say it's an even bigger point. You agree with people like M.R.A. Begh, Hamid Dalvai, even Maxine Rodense, who say that there's a very real sense in which Islam itself puts Muslims at a disadvantage. Again, I want to quote, you say, it is a common observation that Muslim children coming from similar socioeconomic backgrounds do rather poorly in schools and colleges as compared to non-Muslims. The fact that they have remained behind other communities in almost all countries of the world cannot be a matter of sheer coincidence. Can you explain that point a bit more fully?
Well, what I have tried to say here is that there are various problems Muslims are facing. One of the problems is that they are not very, they don't criticize. They are taught from the very beginning to just follow. If you don't have a critical mind, if you do not have a scientific temperament, then you would not be, if you're not questioning what is being taught to you, then your talents will not develop. And that is one reason that because if you are asked to follow blindly without questioning, then your mental faculty remain weak. And that is one reason why you find that not only in India, but also in a very large number of other Muslim countries, countries where Muslims are either in a minority or even a majority. Look at Malaysia, look at Egypt, look at Lebanon. You find that they are far behind other communities which are doing much better. So therefore, entrepreneurship is lacking and critical temperament which is needed for scientific development, that's also lacking.
And this is, in a sense, because of the culture of Islam. It seems to encourage and promote acceptance, obedience, rather than critical questioning.
This is what I feel. I mean, I'm not a very big scholar of Islam, but when I read books by M.R.A. Begg or Hamid Dalvai, I do feel that...
Even Maxime Rodin, sir.
Yeah, that's right. I do feel that there is a great deal of effort which is going to be...
And this is the sense in which Islam is part of the problem that they have to tackle themselves. It puts them at a disadvantage.
Well, see, Islam is capable of being interpreted in a number of ways. It is quite possible to have a very, very liberal interpretation. It's also possible to have a very fundamentalist interpretation. Unfortunately, Sufi Islam, which should have been the greatest strength of Indian Muslims, is being given up by them in favor of Salafi Islam or Wahhabi Islam.
And the more that happens, the greater the acceptance, the greater the obedience, the less the critical questioning.
And the greater would be the amount of prejudice that they would face.
And the greater also would be the sense in which Islam itself becomes part of the disadvantage Muslims face, as you point out.
Right.
Now, there's a very real sense when you say these things that you seem to echo the thinking of Arif Muhammad Khan. Would you agree?
To some extent, yes. In fact, I would entirely agree with him on his stand on the Shah Bano case. That was a very big mistake which Rajiv Gandhi did when he changed the law. Because till that point of time, the understanding was that the civil law was different. But criminal law is the same for all communities. And it was the first time that the criminal law, CRPC, was changed. And said it will be applicable only to non-Muslims and not to Muslims.
And that had implications not just for Muslims, but also for the way Muslims were perceived by non-Muslims.
That's right.
And we know prejudice. What it did to the Rath Yatra and everything else that followed.
It increased prejudice against them. It increased Hindu, and the voting pattern also changed.
My last question. These answers that you've given me about the condition of Muslims, whether it's to do with their attitude and self-perception or whether it's to do with the way in which Islam itself constitutes a disadvantage, will be hated or at least sharply criticized by Indian liberals. Does that worry you, that you might be putting yourself in the line of fire?
In fact, they have been critical of my views. But I take it, okay, everyone is entitled to have their own views. But I do feel that if you 100% support Muslims in all what they do, then in a way you are harming them. I would like to put it 20-60-20. That is, 20% is government's fault, 60% is the fault of Hindus who are biased, and if we do are not addressing this issue of bias, 20% is the Muslim fault. So therefore, they also need to do many things which they are not doing. So
and
like
we
that.
Can't deny that 20% is their own fault.
That's right.
Mr. Saxena,
thank you very much. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. To receive instant updates on all videos from The Wire, click the subscribe button and hit the bell icon. Pay to support independent journalism. Click the link in the description and choose the amount you want to pay.